Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick coming to you from the Appalachian Mountains of North Carolina. I hope you guys are doing all right. I've been on the road again for the last several days by the grace of God. You know, I'm reliving those moments of letting my son and wife take a extended bath time while I'm trying to pray, seek the Lord, and make videos. So God bless the Lord for his grace and mercy. And I thank the Lord for, you know, the family that I have, that my wife also, you know, we put the Lord first, you know, as much as humanly possible. Brothers and sisters, just on that note, I would just say, you know, there are many of you, brothers and sisters, who are worried about, you know, not making the Lord, you know, always the top priority in your life. And I just want to say this to you. There are some of you who I talk to who are, you know, you've got the Lord as your top priority and you're worried about it for no reason. But most people, brothers and sisters, most people, the Lord is not enough of a priority in their life. Amen. But there are a few who the Lord is a priority, and then, you know, they, if we have families, brothers and sisters, if you have a family, you know, the Lord is making me have give a pastoral message, a pastoral comment here. If you have a family, you know, and you're married, you have an obligation to your spouse. You have an obligation to your children, particularly your underage children, of course. Once they're grown, of course, they have their own lives. But we have to have a balance in our walk with the Lord. But I would, you know, 90% of people, their balance is putting their family ahead of God. And then there's 10%. Usually it's pastors. And then some others, you know, we put the Lord in the ministry above all things, and then we, you know, it ends up, you know, out of balance with our families. And then there are some of you who are my subscribers. When I talk, I can, you know, sense it and hear it from the things that you're doing and saying, that sometimes, you know, you're not giving your family that proper, you know, share of your time and your energies and your thoughts and your attention. So, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, the purpose of my YouTube channel, in one way, as a pastor on YouTube, I was just talking to a brother and sister about it just a couple of days ago. I don't know that if there's only two or three people who are ordained ministers who are on YouTube, who are do YouTube ministries. Now, we know that there are videos of television preachers, whomever you want to talk about, Perry Stone, John Hagee, and whomever, Sid Roth, this show, and whatever you want to think of. Of course, their videos are posted on YouTube. I'm talking about people who do a YouTube ministry. There's only a handful of ordained ministers who are on here, you know. And so lots of people, you know, part of the, you know, the day we're living in with the technology as we're coming into the end times. You know, when you read the Bible and it says, you know, in Hebrews, don't forsake your assembling of yourselves together, especially when you see that the end times are near, the times are approaching of the return of Christ. You know, it tells us not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. So that's one Bible only, you know, one Bible verse talking about that that people quote. But of course, in this last generation, in the last, you know, 60 years, there's been television. And I guess Rex Humbart was the first television preacher. There were radio ministries since radio began. And so this is just all in the last 100 years, or 80 years, let's say. So people have had the opportunity to fellowship and hear the preaching of the word, not necessarily in a church, you know, a traditional brick-and-mortar church. So, brothers and sisters, in these last days, especially now, say the last 10 years, or YouTube's been around for whatever it has been, I guess 2005, 2006, so let's say 10 years, basically, almost. So now we can really fellowship and comment, and then we can have a relationship with people through comments, and then you can talk to people on the phone and all that you met from YouTube community or the Facebook, the what do they call it, you know, this cyber community or whatever. So these are things that the Bible, you know, didn't get into, that we can still have fellowship. So therefore, brothers and sisters, many of you guys, a huge amount of people who watch my videos don't go to a church for whatever reason. Probably the biggest reason, same reason why I only go to churches to preach. It's because most of them are not teaching the Word of God. Our brothers and sisters, this is an example. Almost everywhere I go, you know, my subscribers, even though some of them are deacons in the church and some of them are even preachers, but the majority of people that I meet, you know, they're who attend church, when they invite me, you know, they'll tell their pastor, oh, this brother Patrick, who's a missionary in the Philippines, and he's a pastor also, he planted churches, all blah blah blah, and maybe you could let him preach in the church. Well, of course, you've got to be in that little clique of that denomination and all that, brothers and sisters. You know, that's why they keep repeating. You know, they have people that it's just like the news, the mainstream media. People watch Fox News. It's not all people, but there's a big crowd of the military industrial complex who watch Fox News. You know, I'm a conservative, but there are people in the Fox News category who are warmongers, and there are some who promote capitalism. You know, like up here in the mountains of North Carolina, the largest privately owned home in the United States, which you can tour, is called Biltmore House. You know, built by the robber barons, some of the Biltmores who were, you know, they were big in the shipping industry and all that. This is one of the kids of this big wheels in the shipping industry. You know, the robber barons is who they were. Some people call them the industrialists, the robber barons, the Gilded Age. You know, capitalism totally untamed, where they can just squash and crush everyone, where there's no middle class, where there's no, I don't want to get into politics too much. I am a conservative, I'm a libertarian, but, you know, the government's job is to keep a level playing field. In other words, trust busting, like what Teddy Roosevelt did. You know, you've got this, you know, they had Standard Oil and all this. That's where these people had wealth beyond anything today. I read that John D. Rockefeller had more money than our J.P. Morgan, too. I think John D. Rockefeller was the richest. He had more money than like the top 40 or 50 people on today's Forbes 500 list. You know, no one today has the kind of wealth that those robber barons had. So that's why they were able to build a house that covers 4 acres. The house, under one roof, a house is 4 acres big. It's like, seems like it's, is it 30,000 or 300,000 square feet? Whatever, you'd have to calculate it out. 4 acres for the house alone, seated on 8,000 acres of land, which is the remainder. There was more before. So anyway, when they... You know, our mansions in heaven, brothers and sisters, are much more important. You know, what good does it do a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? You know, this is all the flesh stuff. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to get to a point with that, because I was thinking about that because I'm in that area the last couple of days, visiting with some brothers and sisters, brothers and sister in the Lord, doing some, you know, ministry with them, ministering to them, and visiting with them and fellowshipping. So praise God for that. I want to thank them. I want to thank all the brothers and sisters who I meet with. But anyway, when I go to a place, people will say, "Hey, Brother Patrick, you know, maybe the pastor will let you preach in our church." And then, of course, as I said, you've got these people who are building their own kingdom, so in the kingdom of their denomination. And, I went down that rabbit trail. Let me go back. So, in other words, Fox News and CNN and all those guys, you know, they're preaching to the choir. And I mentioned about Fox, and as I said, I'm a conservative. You know, you go to MSNBC, and they're reinforcing the doctrine that Obama is God, you know, and everything's great, and you know, Obamacare's great, and, you know, we need to be socialist, and, you know, all this, you know, the fairness that's not the fairness I'm talking about. I'm talking about a fair playing field, that you can't have monopolies and all that, and that, you know, people have that American opportunity, the American dream, that if you work hard and play by the rules, you can become, you know, the next Bill Gates. You know, as you know, that American dream, that why the whole world wants to come here in the natural, is the fact that we have that opportunity. Whether you be black, white, brown, you know, whatever your religion. Even though, you know, we are Christians, but we have freedom of religion here. Of course, we don't want a religion that wants to come in and kill us off. We don't agree with them. You know, and most of you are probably thinking I'm talking about Islam, but I'm thinking about hundreds of years of history of Catholicism killing a lot of people that didn't agree with them much more than the Muslims have done. Anyways, I want you guys to remember that, because that's going to become very important as we're heading into the tribulation period. What is Christianity? You know, the divide is coming. I don't know how much we'll see before the rapture, you know, between biblical Christianity and Babylonian captivity religion of Roman Catholicism, and bringing all the world's religions into one world religion. Anyway, you know me, brothers and sisters, I'm touching and going somewhere with all these topics. So so when you see CNN and MSNBC and Fox, they just reinforce, they're preaching to the choir. They reinforce the beliefs they have, and then therefore the people who are watching that, they're in that paradigm, you know. And so Fox News is pumping everybody up for war for them, because that's their, you know, that's the side of the fence they're on, of that false paradigm You know, the it's like world, you know, the World Wrestling Federation, you know. All these politicians act like they're enemies in public, and they have their little talking points and wedge issues. You know, the Republicans say, oh, we're against abortion, but yet they do nothing about it. The Democrats say, oh, we're going to help, you know, minorities, we're going to help black people. But do they do anything? No. As a matter of fact, I mean, they end up hurting all the people, and all the money goes in their pocket, all the power goes to them as we're building into the New World Order. So the same thing is true with your denominations. They have, their denomination was founded on one, you know, truth, revelation of God. Like I've mentioned this before, let's look at Luther, you know, Martin Luther. You know, the Lord gave him the revelation and the illumination from the Bible that the just shall live by faith. That one point. But Martin Luther didn't have the, you know, the revelation that baptism is immersion in water. He didn't have the revelation that, you know, that about speaking in tongues. He didn't have the revelation, you know, about evangelizing people and all that, to be an evangelical. So the peace that God gave him is the Lord was returning his church to the original state. And that's a whole other topic. You know me, brothers and sisters, I'm all over the place. The church has been going, you know, it went in reverse from the beginning into the dark ages, into the darkness of Roman Catholicism. And I mentioned this in the book. I put a little chart in there and everything. And then it came out of that, really, with Martin Luther. We've really been living in the restoration of the Pentecostal church, the original church. You know, I was just talking to this sister, you know, that I met here yesterday, and a brother, and, you know, they were talking about, you know, the traditional, you know, there's lots of people that, you know, that are, you know, religious and traditional, and they don't believe in speaking in tongues. And then, you know, I just thought about it, and I told them then it's really true that traditional Christianity is Pentecostal, because the day the church was born, the church was Pentecostal on the day of Pentecost, speaking in tongues. So the real tradition is what we see in the book of Acts. The real tradition is the Bible. And what we've been doing, what God's been doing through his people since the time of Martin Luther and the Moravians and John Huss before that there in Prague, the Lord has been returning his church back to the real traditional church and removing the darkness. Okay, brothers and sisters. So when I go places, people will say, hey, Brother Patrick, why don't you come to our church and visit? Why don't you come to our church and visit? You know, just and sit in the church. You know, but I don't go, brothers and sisters, and I'll tell you why. As most of you who watch these videos know, for yourself, you know, number one, I am a pastor. I am a minister of the gospel. And I can, and just like you guys, I can go on the internet and the Lord leads me. No, I don't watch people on YouTube calculating the rapture date. I go on the internet like Sermon Index. That's why I want to give you guys a couple of references. SermonIndex.net, I think it is. I go on there and listen to the classic sermons of the great men of God. And they're from all denominations, like Leonard Ravenhill. My favorite preacher probably is Leonard Ravenhill. There's some Baptist preachers who are also great, like the brother E.V. Hill. He's dead now. Probably one of the best preachers you'll ever hear is Brother E.V. Hill. He was a black preacher from Los Angeles, California, who was a Baptist. So those of you who watch my videos, you know I'm down on Baptists. I came from a Baptist background, and I know that Baptists are very pharisaical, self-righteous hypocrites. And many of them are very blasphemous toward the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues and all that. And in their ignorance of the things of the Spirit, they know not what they do. But some of the greatest men of God were Baptists. You know, and the Baptists, like my ancestors, they were Anabaptists in England, you know, and they came to the New World because of religious persecution. And, you know, they withstood the Anglican Church. You know, they withstood the false doctrine of the Anglican Church at that time. You know, so there's many mighty men of God in all those denominations, like Martin Luther himself, as I mentioned him earlier. He stood against the tyranny and lies, satanic antichrist spirit of the Pope. And he called the Pope Antichrist. And so he's not the Antichrist, but he is a Antichrist. He stands against Christ. He tries to put himself in the place of Christ, the vicar of Christ, as an example. So there's mighty men of God in all denominations. But brothers and sisters, just like you, I'm not going to sit in a dead church. I'm not going to sit under nonsense. During that same time, you can go on the internet, you could find a great sermon of a great man of God, as I mentioned. Now, there's no recorded sermons of him, probably the greatest Baptist preacher that ever lived, and he's known as the Prince of Preachers. That's Spurgeon, you know, and he had some, but, you know, you'd have to read it, or maybe someone reads it, you know, there's probably an audio recording of someone who read his sermon. Still not the same as hearing the original speaker. Old General Booth, they call him General Booth, who started the Salvation Army, William Booth. Great men of God, great men of God. So I encourage you to listen to great men of God and get the right spirit in you, the anointing of God, from men of God who sought the Lord, who spent their time in the presence of God, seeking Him, glorifying Him, worshiping Him, and being used by Him to do, you know, to say great and mighty things that the Lord would lead them by the Spirit. You know, and if you're in a dead church, you know, all over this world, if you're in a dead church, come out from among the dead. Let the dead bury the dead. Come out from among them. You know, there's very few people, you know, who are mature enough and called by God to go back and be salt and light in a dead church. Lots of people say, oh, I'm going to be there because I'm going to be salt and light. If the Lord had led you to do that, of course, there are some who the Lord leads to do that. But many of you brothers and sisters who are watching on YouTube are new Christians, or you just came back to the Lord recently. You've been backslider for years. You know, the Lord has called you out to get prepared for the rapture, to prepare for the end times. You know, and you don't have any discipleship. You know, and that's why you're on here now. And I'm here by the grace of God to disciple you. I love all you guys. I love all of God's people. I'm here to minister to God's people. You know, and sometimes I do a little some evangelism, but my ministry is to the church, to the bride. You know, and that's what I'm here for, to disciple you, to be in the stead of Christ, to help you, to minister to you as His hands and His voice sometimes, as He would, by His grace, would use me. And I love all you guys. I'm here for you. I'm here to help you, you know, and that's what I want to do, brothers and sisters. And I'm here to help you come out of dead religion. And it don't matter what denomination it is. And there are denominational churches, you know, that are on fire for God. I know there's very few. You know, I don't know where any are now, but there are a few. You know, and it could be any denomination. Doesn't matter. But brothers and sisters, you know, generally speaking, you know, you need to be in a spirit-filled church that is rooted and grounded in the Word. Now, that's very hard to find. Very hard to find. So, like I say, if I could recommend a church. Now, a lot of them have gone off the deep end. The church I came out of has gone off the cliff. But the denomination Assemblies of God was started to bring balance between, you know, it was started by one Methodist preacher and one Baptist preacher that got filled with the Holy Spirit. So he started Assemblies of God to bring balance between, you know, to be Baptist-costal, really, to bring that rooted and grounded in the Word doctrine together with the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. Some of them, you know, when we do have some revivals, usually you will see it coming from a Church of God or Assemblies of God in that area. So if you can find one of those two churches in your area. Now, if you're more into the intellectual side, and I'm just saying straight up, it's a general statement, the intellectual crowd of theology, you're going to find in the Assemblies of God. The more stronger point of anointing and more of a, you get more of a rule crowd and more, you know, worship and praising the Lord. You're going to see that in a Church of God. Church of God originates from Appalachia and Tennessee. So you get a whole lot more, you know, farmers and that type of people, even though today most people are not farmers. But, you know, you have that more of a crowd. So it's, you know, it's more worshiping and praising, and the anointing to me, in my experience, is stronger in the Church of God than Assemblies of God. But Assemblies of God is more of an intellectual group in the fact that they, you know, they keep you really rooted and grounded in the Word. You know, and they bring those two together. So it depends on what type of person you are, you know, what you like. If you're more of a rural person and you're a, you know, a country person and you just want to keep it simple and worship the Lord, go to a Church of God. If you, you know, want to get into more theology of it and stuff, you know, and you know, go to Assemblies of God. Now, that's my personal recommendation to you guys. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've touched on lots of different topics here that I can make a message about. But I had some dreams from the Lord. And the Lord showed me, you know, bringing in those last sheep for, you know, who will be revived, brothers and sisters. And I've said this before, and I can't say everything in every video, but it's true. I feel in my spirit America's too far gone. It's never coming back. It's my opinion. But there are individuals who will be revived. There's individuals from all over the, you know, basically revival is for Christians to be revived. You know, you can't be vived. You know, to be vived, to be saved, but revived, revival. So I see that revival is the Spirit breaking out on those who are lukewarm and setting them on fire. And then they can be used by God to win other, you know, the lost to the Lord. You know what I'm saying? A fruit of revival is new believers. But revival itself is God getting a hold of His people who are asleep at the wheel. You know, and the American church is asleep at the wheel. 90% of them have gone off the cliff. You know, I don't want to even get into all this stuff. All these preachers, leaders meeting with the Pope and all this kind of stuff, and the Pope's message is really come back and be reconciled to Rome, and they all think it's cool and great, and you know that, you know, they're all getting prepped for Chrislam and the New World Religion and all that stuff. It's all coming together, brothers and sisters. But there is a remnant, you know, and a lot of people are connecting through things like YouTube, Facebook, and all that. God has put us together for such a time as this, brothers and sisters. We together are the children of the living God. We together are the bride. And so we together have to do what God wants us to do. We have to be prepared to meet the Lord in the air. You know, and I've made videos before and telling you guys this, and then I'll come on, make a video, and I'll talk about it and preach. You know, but the root of what God has got me doing, the flow of the river of God in me, is to prepare the bride to be without spot, without blemish, to meet the Lord in the air. That's why the Lord gave me the name for our online church, Church of the Firstborn. The link is below here. We have a prayer team. If you need to be prayed for, you have a prayer request, please submit it on the website. If you want to be part of the prayer team, you know, if you're a mature Christian, hey, we'll make a determination and add you if there's some specialty area that the Lord uses you in. You know, healing is a big area where we need people for prayer warriors. We need people as prayer warriors for the orphanage. You know, I think we got about, there's 12 prayer warriors. That's what we have. I'd like to have 120. Brothers and sisters, let it be tenfold in Jesus' name. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to do something for the Lord. Now, you know, I've been making this long video, and you know me, I just, you know, shifting gears, but staying on topic somehow to get you guys ready to meet the Lord. I guess that's the theme, right? The Bible says in James, don't be a hearer of the word, but be a doer of the word. Even demons, the Bible says in James, that demons believe in God and tremble. But don't ye know, O ye vain man, faith without works is dead. And it says to be ye a doer of the word, not a hearer only. James says, you show me your faith without works, and I'll show you my faith by my works. Now, lots of these old religious people, and I go back to Baptists, I mentioned them first, because, you know, that's where they're getting out of bounds with this. They get out of balance with this. It's not that you're saved by your works, but the Bible says in Ephesians right there that people quote, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, it says, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. In the same chapter, a few verses later, Paul says you're saved unto do good works. God has predestined a destiny for us. I need to make a whole nother video on this. Is the Lord is, you know, brothers and sisters, the Lord is always exercising me and my faith. You know, the Lord will give me lots of messages. Then when I get on here, the Lord will redirect me into something. He always does that to me. But brothers and sisters, I need to make a video about this. But if I make it and title it this, you know, maybe, you know, hardly nobody will watch it, because everybody is ready to go in the rapture, but when they get there for all eternity, they're going to be up there with no rewards. And there's, you know, these people, they feign humility. Oh, I don't care about any rewards. I just want to be there. Yes, the Lord wants us to have rewards. What's the point of the rewards? It shows that we gave the Lord the rewards of his suffering. The Bible says the Lord, you know, that we're, you know, the Lord would have the rewards of his suffering. The Lord has not raptured us yet. When you got saved, you didn't get raptured, didn't float off the earth, you didn't die and go to heaven the moment you got saved. Why? The Lord left you here to be salt and light. The Lord left you here to do something. And I, you know, let me go back to that topic. I got to make another video. 90% of people that I meet that are Christians, that are even on fire for God, they're not doing nothing for the Lord. It's all about them and their personal spiritual experiences with the Lord. There's one brother I've been wrestling with for 3 years. And it's, you know, it's just all about having some experience with the Lord. It's all about this inner focus of me, self. When God didn't call us to do that, as I always quote the acronym JOY, Jesus first, others second, yourself last. When you put Jesus first, others second, and yourself last, you will have joy. Joy comes from putting Jesus first in your life, others second, like your family, your friends, the stranger. As Jesus said, those who cannot pay you back. You know, Jesus said, when you have a banquet, invite the maimed, the lame, the halt, all these people who you know can never pay you back, and then God will reward you. When you do what they call porpavor, like in the Philippines, when you invite people to a banquet who are rich people and politicians or whomever, knowing that, hey, they're going to pay you back somehow because they're somebody, they have the means to help you out in politics or whatever it is, in finances, then your reward is from them, not from the Lord. Brothers and sisters, we are supposed to be serving the Lord. That's a whole nother topic besides getting right with the Lord. And that's where people are missing it. It even says that, you know, Peter even says that when, you know, you lead somebody to the Lord and you serve the Lord, it covers a multitude of sins. You know, but being out there being a doer and serving God instead of just sitting around all talk. And that's the biggest problem probably in the church. The YouTube church is people sitting around talking and debating doctrines and theories and calculation rapture dates instead of getting out there and being that salt and light, being like John the Baptist, preparing the way of the Lord, doing the will of God, that the destiny that God has in your life. Very few of you. There's a brother in Dallas who I talk to. Now, he, you know, every day he goes and talks to people about Jesus. He just talks to people about Jesus. Everybody he meets, he says, well, you know, I try to steer the conversation and talk about Jesus. You know, I mean, that's his thing, you know, is steering people to talk about Jesus, finding out if they're saved, you know, find out where they are with the Lord. Are they saved? Are they backslidden? You know, have they totally fallen away? They stopped believing in the Lord or whatever. That's what one of my buddies in Dallas does. Praise the Lord for that. He's one of the few people who's, you know, that I talk to that's, hey, guess what, brother? You know, I talked to somebody about Jesus today. I told somebody the gospel today, and we fellowshipped and talked about Jesus. And this guy knows he needs to, you know, improve his walk with the Lord. You know, he knows he's kind of lukewarm and backslidden. Hey, you know, we talked about it, and he's going to, you know, come back toward the Lord some more. You know, get his life back right with the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. For that, brothers and sisters, there's very few and far between. I got to make a video about it. Brothers and sisters. You know, God is preparing us to meet him in the air. Brothers and sisters, our time here is short, short, short. It's time to go. It's time to meet the Lord in the air, brothers and sisters. And we must finish the race that he called us to. You know, brothers and sisters, I was talking to another sister down there in South Carolina. And we were talking, you know, and Jesus said that, you know, he's going to come back when this gospel of the kingdom is preached in the whole world, then the end shall come. You know, when the fullness of the Gentiles happens, you know, then that'll be the time that God will begin to deal with Israel again, the tribulation period. Time of Jacob's trouble. It's the time when Yahweh's strange work, the Bible calls it, when God begins to deal with Israel again, directly, only, when the bride has been removed, tribulation period. There's just an X amount of Gentile people are supposed to get saved. And then the rapture will happen. And then the tribulation will begin. And brothers and sisters, it could be you or me that's supposed to lead that last person to the Lord. This is our great commission. This is the commandment from the Lord. Go ye in all the world, making disciples of the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You know, the Lord said he would be with us always, even to the end of the age. Now that I mentioned that, there are many of you who say, I think the Lord is not with me anymore. The Lord has forsaken me and all this. Jesus promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. The Lord has promised us he would never leave us nor forsake us. Now, if you backslide and go, as the Bible says, you know, when you go lie with a harlot, you know, you're making the Lord lie with a harlot, and you're grieving the Holy Spirit and all these things. So, of course, when we go into darkness and we grieve the Holy Spirit and we separate ourselves from the Lord, well, you know, the Lord is still there, but we've separated ourselves. But the ones who ask me about it, they're the ones who are walking with the Lord, trying their best. They might make a little mistake. They sin here and there, as we all do. They accidentally sin and stumble. They get back up. They try to repent. They think God didn't forgive them. And they're living in this condemnation and doubt and unbelief. Brothers and sisters, that's from the enemy. I need to make a whole video about that. You know me, I just hodgepodge it together. You know, I shoot a shotgun, a sawed-off shotgun. I blast everywhere, brothers and sisters. Because, you know, everybody can't watch every video. There's, you know, and I believe that's the nature of the way the Lord uses it for the YouTube, that I'm hitting all these areas in one video. It's not really like just a straight up sermon on one topic and sticking with it totally. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know that I love you guys. You know that God loves you. That's the main thing, that the Lord loves you, that he's coming for his bride. Brothers and sisters, let's get in lined up with God's will in your life. Let's get lined up. Let's get lined up. I love you guys. I'll be back down there in South Carolina in the Low Country here in another day or so. And I'll be coming to you. I might try to make some more videos today by the grace of God if he'll lead me into it. And bless you guys, the anointing oil. I think I got everything about now. And I'm going to be, you know, finalizing, praying over it some more. And I ask any of you guys who, you know, who feel led by the Lord to pray for that anointing oil, that it will do God's will. And, you know, the Lord was just speaking to me about it yesterday, and I'll make a video about this too, that the anointing oil, of course, God is going to use that, you know, anointing oil as a point of faith and a point of contact for anything, healing and all this. But, you know, I used to really have a huge healing ministry, brothers and sisters, before. And then when I moved to the Philippines, you know, so the first 4 or 5 years, my ministry was a huge healing, more a lot of healings. And the Lord began to move me in the prophetic, brothers and sisters, as I grew in the Lord. And now, you know, my main ministry from the Lord is prophetic. And then people get healed there too. But the focus of my ministry is calling the church to the mind of Christ, to the heart of Christ, to the Word of God, you know, to the Rhema word, which is a, you know, a word from the Word. Right now, what's God's vision? What's God's mission for you as an individual and for your local church, for your denomination, for the country and all those things? This is really what prophetic is all about. Not necessarily giving people word, oh, God's going to make you a millionaire and all this kind of stuff. You know, even though God does give exhortative words. But I always, let me say this for those of you who know, have a little bit of knowledge and can be dangerous. The gift of prophecy for the church is for anyone in the church to get up and speak in tongues and someone interpret is the same as someone standing up in the church and prophesying. It tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and 12 and 14, it's telling us that when someone prophesies in the church, any member of the church stands up and gives a word, it's to exhort that church. But brothers and sisters, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, we see that there are four different offices, actually. A lot of people think it's five, but teacher and pastor are really one in the Greek. That's why in the King James it says, you know, pastor and teacher, pastor, teacher. It's really one title. So there's really four different types of ministries. You know, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, whatever. Yeah, evangelist, pastor, teacher. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. So there's four different types of offices. So the offices, don't get the offices confused with the gifts. Don't get the offices confused with the gift. Anybody who is a Christian, who is filled with the Holy Spirit, baptized in the Holy Spirit, God can use you in any of the gifts of the Spirit. As he wills, it says. As the Holy Spirit wills. He divides those gifts severally among us as he wills. So God could give you the gift of prophecy. He could use you in a group of people where two or more of you are gathered in my name. There I am in the midst of them. Two or more people gathered in the name of Jesus. That's the church. That's the local church manifested. You can operate in the gift. And when you speak a prophecy or tongues with interpretation, and that interpretation is a prophecy, same thing. It's like two nickels equals a dime or one dime. You know, prophecy being a dime. Tongues with interpretation, a nickel each, they equal the same thing. So when someone gives that word, it's an exhortation for that group. It's an exhortation for that group. Or if you're all from one local church, and you're meeting, and then it would be for the exhortation of your church. That's different than the office of a prophet. Just like anyone can evangelize, but there are evangelists. We have a special anointing from God as leaders in the church, elders in the church. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so that's another topic we have to deal with on YouTube, brothers and sisters, because one of the downside of YouTube is you have a lot of anarchists in the church. You know, and then the extreme opposite of that is Roman Catholicism, you know, where you have a dictator. They declare the Pope is infallible. He cannot be wrong. When he's speaking as the Pope, he's speaking as Christ. Everything he says is like God. It's like writing a new verse into the Bible. He's infallible. That's what they believe. So that's extreme. Really the definition of a cult. Definition of a cult is one leader who gets secret knowledge and wisdom. You know, and he has the access. And then whatever he says is God speaking. It was like David Koresh and the Branch Davidians. The Pope has that same power. People just don't see it as a cult because it's so big. And that's the problem we face of delusion in the end times. Lots of people are mixing, and there's all these 50 shades of gray in Christianity, mixing all this false doctrine in with real doctrine. what the Bible says, and demonic spew vomit of Babylonian mystery religion. As an example, those fish mouth hats that they wear from worship of Dagon. Go look it up. Dagon fish hat. You'll see it's the exact same hat that the Pope and these bishops wear. Just one of a million demonic false doctrines mixed in with Christianity. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so we have the extreme of all this demonic dictatorship. Those people are the ones that's going to be enforcing the mark. All those Roman Catholics that do not get born again, even though I believe by the grace of God many of them will come out, those who are dyed in the wool Roman Catholics, they will do, you know, it's a shadow of things to come. What happened in the Dark Ages is a shadow of things to come. Torturing, killing anyone that doesn't agree with their doctrine. Just like what Islam, people talk about Islam. Roman Catholicism has killed more people than Islam ever did. 100 times more. Go research it. Go research the Inquisitions and all of these things. Calling themselves part of the body of Christ. But on the extreme other end, brothers and sisters. Matter of fact, I told a Roman Catholic that, you know, when two or more are gathered, I quoted Jesus, when two or more are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. This old Roman Catholic started laughing. Ha, 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 ha. What? That doesn't make any sense. No, that's what Jesus said. So, of course, I would expect a foul spirit to mock that because, you know, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. When the Catholic Church says you must die in a state of grace to enter heaven, how do you die in a state of grace? By receiving the sacraments of our church. What are the sacraments? Last rites, taking the communion from the hand of a priest. Only a priest, under the authority of the Pope, can give you communion. You receive grace. That's a work. When you eat the communion, you're literally eating the flesh and literally drinking the blood of Christ. They call it vitamin J. Take your vitamin J, then you receive grace, it's infused into you, and then through that, and the last rites, or extreme unction, they call it, and the sacraments like being made a priest, and the wedding ceremony, all this, these things give you grace, and then you must die in a state of grace to enter heaven. So if the Catholic Church says you're excommunicated because something you believe that we don't agree with, therefore you can't take communion from the hand of the priest only, because it only transubstantiates, it only turns to flesh and blood in the hand of the priest during the Mass, then you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. So the Catholic Church is saying, we are the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except you receive the sacraments of the Catholic Church. You see what I'm saying? So they put themselves in the place of Christ. So it is great that the Pope calls himself the Vicar of Christ, in place of Christ, because he's made a new gospel, that you must submit to the teachings and the ceremonies and the works of the Catholic Church in order to earn your way to heaven. Very simple, brothers and sisters. But on the other end, there's many of you on YouTube who are anarchists. You think, you know, you'll quote the Bible where it says, you know, where it says God is no respecter of persons. But in that text, God's talking about getting saved. You're talking about getting saved. God is no respecter of persons to get born again. But he does call people. He elects people and calls people. Like he said, Esau have I hated, but Jacob have I loved, and Esau have I hated. And as Paul says there, I believe that's in Romans chapter 9, he says, you know, who are you, you know, to say to the potter, why have you made me like this? You know, some vessels are made for honor, some for dishonor, some of gold, some of wood. And who are you, the clay, to say to the potter, why have you made me this way? So brothers and sisters, we are made by God for different callings. And that's the whole point of what I'm trying to say in the bottom line of this video. God is, you know, we're getting ready to be raptured. God's trying to get his bride ready. You know, and all of you guys are just all freaked out about getting ready and then trying to set dates. But once you get ready, you need to go out and minister to those who are not ready. You need to help others get ready. Serve the Lord in all the capacity that God would allow you to. Not everyone, you know, is called to make YouTube videos and be a pastor. Not everyone's called to the prophetic ministry. Not everyone's called to be an evangelist. But you're called to do something. To serve the body of Christ, whether it's an intercessor, prayer warrior, whether it's to be a, you know, to become successful in business and build orphanages in the Philippines, buy Bibles and give them away, or whatever the Lord would call you to do, brothers and sisters, whatever you're calling, you need to do it. I've said this in 100 videos, and this is the word of the Lord. 90% of people are not doing squat. They're just squatting, but they're not doing squat. God has a calling on your life, brothers and sisters. I'm going to go. You know me, I keep rambling. God bless you guys. You know that I love you. And do God's will. Stop clowning around. Stop fooling around. Stop talking about it. Stop living in this fantasy land and all this on and on and on nonsense. And it's all about you. You know, that's why I start singing that song. You know, there's a worship song for the Lord. You know, it's all about you. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made it. But it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. But, you know, lots of times I think of that song when I'm dealing with people. You know, it's all about them. It's all about you. It's all about you and not Jesus. Sad to say, brothers and sisters, there's lots of people like that. You know, you got to stop. The Bible says that it's a mirror in James. The Bible is a mirror. You know, we're supposed to look in the mirror and see ourselves the way God does. And then change. And then go on to do what God wants us to do. There's many of you who are saying, well, you know, I've got a problem with pornography. You know, I got this issue with pornography. You know, and I'm asking the Lord to deliver me for that. What you need to do is you need to crucify your flesh. You need to crucify your flesh. You know, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, you know, the Lord before me. So, you know, you have to put the world behind you. You know, forsake those things of the world. You got to forsake them. You know, and that's a whole other message I need to make on that. There's so many people say, you know, I need the Lord to, you know, to deliver me out of this sin. No, you don't need to worry about leaving sin. You need to run to Jesus. Run to Jesus. Run to the cross. Get on the cross. Get on the cross with Christ. The Bible says that Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. The Bible says that Paul said, I die daily. I die daily. We're supposed to crucify our flesh. Get on the cross with Christ. Well, you know, that's why, you know, when I used to go to this Christian bookstore when I first became a pastor, it's online only now. It's called the Master's Law. They had a t-shirt, you know, it said, Dead Man Walking. Dead Man Walking. You know that movie, there was a movie, Dead Man Walking, before. And then, you know, as the Bible verse on there, you know, I'm crucified with Christ. And so I no longer live, but Christ in me. You know, why don't you guys read the New Testament sometime? Stop trying to read the Old Testament prophets and read yourself in there, you know. They call it iso-Jesus instead of exo-Jesus. Exo-Jesus is, you know, getting out of the Word what it says. But many people use iso-Jesus. They read themselves into the Word. That's where these cults come from. You know, they put themselves in the text. Stop trying to read the Old Testament prophecies and predicting when the rapture is going to be. And read the New Testament, you know, and see what God wants you to do today in the church age. You know, I don't think we need, all these people are trying to be experts on calculating the rapture. I've already said it about 10 times. Anyway, God bless you guys. I'm going to go back and make videos on these topics. By the grace of God, by His leading. This is an overview for you guys. You know how it is, so you'll see what I'm talking about on my videos when I title them. You can go watch it if it interests you. And I know I promised people I'd make videos. I can only make them as the Lord leads me. So God bless you guys. I love you guys. I'll see you soon, again, by His grace, and soon we'll be meeting in the air. And I've had an overwhelming response about the oil. Brothers and sisters, I'll be ready to get it out here in a few weeks, maybe after next week. So let's see. I got some more traveling to do next weekend and speak at a church and all this. So that's November 2nd. So the next week, after November 2nd, you know, I'm going to make sure I pray over the oil a lot. And you know, ask you guys, as I said, who are intercessors, to pray for the oil also, that it will deliver I know what the Lord's going to use it for. That's what I was trying to tell you before the Lord spoke to me, that the oil would be a prophetic anointing in that oil. That's the anointing I have, prophetic anointing. And there's people will be healed and all that too, but it's a prophetic anointing. When you will anoint yourself with this oil and then pray for others, anoint them with the oil, that it would release a prophetic word. You know, that's what we're talking about, calling out people's destiny, calling out churches' missions, individuals' mission, and destiny in Christ. That's what the prophetic anointing is all about. Calling people from, you know, from the path they're on to the heart of Christ for their life and for their church, for their ministry. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Do the ministry that God called you to do, whether it's mowing grass at some widow's house, whether it's cooking food at somebody's house and giving food away to poor people, or whatever the Lord would call you to do. Pray for people to be healed. If the Lord calls you to donate to Joshua's ministry, do that. Let's build some more orphanages. Let's feed some more street kids. let's do all those things that God would have us do. Praise God. Let's do it. God bless you guys.